check off things there that you're interested in, fill out the bottom of the form, and turn that in a box out on the, or you can just put it on the Wisconsin Grassroots table that's in the hallway before you leave today. Then the other assignment you have before you leave today is to fill out the evaluation form. The evaluation forms are very helpful to us. We consult them every year as we plan this event. So fill that out as you go along, or fill it out at the end of the day. There's a general category of evaluating the whole day. So if you'd fill that out, that would be helpful to us. So that kind of summarizes the overall background of the day. We live in a very challenging political time, as we all know. We're challenged every day by all kinds of things. As a matter of fact, on our table, Grassroots table out the hallway, we're selling constitutions for $1. That's intentional. We think somebody ought to be reminding one another of what the Constitution actually says. Of course, there's a whole lot of issues about what's real and what isn't. But at least the Constitution is a very clear printed document. And the right, of course, flashed their constitutions through the years. Maybe it's our turn to remind everybody that there is such a thing as an actual written constitution with separation of powers as a way, of course, to deter an authoritarian government. The main thing, of course, one of the main things that our founding fathers were very apprehensive about was the abuse of authoritarian power. They lived under the influence of monarchies, and for thousands of years had seen their abuse. And so they were preparing to avert the dangers of authoritarian governments. And I don't think there's probably ever been a time in our history but where the democracy has been more threatened than perhaps at the time of the Civil War when the country was ripping apart than right now. So it's all hands on deck. And you and I, we're all part of those hands. So at this point, I think we'll start into our program. We have a number of presenters, and the sooner we can get on with the program, the better the chances we aren't going to fall behind. So thank you again for coming. After the first breakout session, which will follow our presentations, you go to your breakout sessions, and after that, you go to the cafeteria for lunch. The cafeteria is right over here. The chili is brewing as we speak. We will invite you to support our effort here at lunch. We will be selling some various baked goods. There will be opportunities to donate because we only raise funds this time of the year. We don't send you an email saying, please give us $2, $3, $4, $10. This is it. We talk to you personally. We invite you personally to help us. And this is it. So if you keep that in mind as you go through the day, there's things for sale, there's concessions, and plenty of opportunities for you to donate if you so choose. Thank you again, everyone, for being here. We appreciate your support, and we appreciate your role as good citizens working to defend our democracy. Our first. Speaker is a longtime participant in Wisconsin Grassroots Network. He's worked diligently on the subject of election integrity. It's not only, of course, on getting people to vote, but it's also being sure the votes are counted. And so she's going to talk a little about election integrity and what she learned by being very involved in the recount process. So Karen McKim, thank you. Karen McKim.
Of the Wisconsin Election Integrity Action Team, a volunteer gig I took on after retiring from a 30-year career in state government in quality assurance and management auditing. And mostly I'm going to talk about voting rights today, the full range of our voting rights, not just the right to cast a vote, but the right to have that vote counted, and the right to make sure that the people who govern us were put there by our votes and by nothing else. But before I talk about voting machines, I want to talk about ATMs. These two systems are very analogous in a way, and it helps us to think straight about what we should expect of computerized decision-making systems if we think about both at the same time. Now, your local election official will tell you the voting machines are fine because they are federally certified. There's federal standards that govern voting machines, and that is true. There are federal regulations and standards that govern both ATMs and voting machines. And it is true that the standards that govern voting, the ATMs, are more rigorous, more up-to-date, and better enforced. But your local election officials are telling you the truth when they say that your voting machine probably did meet federal standards that were in effect at the time your voting machine was new. Your local election official will also tell you that they do the very best IT security that is within their power to protect these voting machines from problems and from hacking and from manipulation. And that is also true. They do the very best job that they are able with IT security. It is also true that at the bank, they own and control the software that runs the ATMs and counts your dollars, and they can inspect that software for problems. It is true that at the bank, they have a full-time professional staff of IT security experts working day in and day out to ensure the integrity of these ATMs. Your town clerk does the very best he or she can with what the resources he or she has available to him. Now, in both of these systems, you make a deposit. In this system, you deposit your paycheck and you trust that the dollars will be credited to the right account. In this system, you deposit a ballot and you trust that the votes will be credited to the right candidate. Now let's take a look at what happens at the end of the business day. In this system, the system with the better federal regulation and the more professional IT management, the contents of that ATM will be reconciled against the computer tape at the end of every business day. The transactions will be audited both at the banks that sent the money and the banks that received the money. Every day, they will check to make sure everything stays accurate. And at the end of the month, they will send you a statement that you yourself can verify that your deposit was credited to the right account. At the end of the business day, over in this machine where you've made a deposit, the poll workers will check that the system kept track of the right number of transactions. They will check to make sure they have the right number of ballots. But they won't check that your votes were credited to the right candidate. They'll pack up the election results and they'll send them to the municipal campus, which will have a week to review the election results, and they will not check to make sure that your votes were credited to the right candidate. The municipal campus will certify the results to the county campus. The county campus will have another week to look at the election results, and they will not check to make sure that your votes were credited to the right candidate. They will, at the end of that week, sign a statement that says, we have reviewed these election results and we have found them to be true and correct. And they will send them to the State Elections Commission without checking their accuracy. The Wisconsin Elections Commission will add up the certified results from all the counties and will certify them as our statewide results without checking to make sure that your votes were credited to the right candidate. And then the new president, or governor, or senator, or congressional representative, or state legislature will be sworn into office, and no one will ever have checked to make sure that your vote was credited to the right candidate. Now, 20 other states require local election officials to check accuracy before certification, but Wisconsin is not one of them. Wisconsin allows it. Any municipal clerk or county clerk could check accuracy if they wanted to, but they don't. Now, let's look at what happens when customers suspect an error. If you get a bank statement and you say, that's not right, my checking account should have more money than that, you can call the bank or go to the bank, and they'll sit down with you and they'll review the records, and they'll either prove them accurate or they will find the error and correct it and do an adjustment on your bank statement. These managers over here don't just see their job as counting dollars. They see their job as counting dollars accurately. And they consider that verifying that accuracy is a routine part of their job as managers. What happens over here when the customers, the voters, say, that's not right, that's not the person who was predicted to get Wisconsin's electoral votes, how about you check accuracy? They will go to their election officials and say, check that before you certify it. And the local election officials will point to the Wisconsin recount statutes and say, you're just a voter, you don't have standing to ask for verified accuracy. Only a candidate has standing to ask for a recount. It's your vote, but you cannot ask us to verify accuracy. So then, once in a blue moon, a candidate does come forward and does ask for a recount. Someone like Jill Stein will step forward and say, Wisconsin voters are entitled to verified accuracy, and I demand a recount. And at that point, what will Wisconsin election officials say to that candidate? They will say that unless you suspect an error that's 0.25% or smaller, you have to pay the full estimated cost of that verification. You have to pay it upfront in cash. You have to raise $3.2 million in cash over the Thanksgiving holiday, or we will not verify the accuracy of our work product. That's what happens in these two systems. Now, I have been on this election integrity gig for 5 years, and I have been asked dozens of times, but is there a problem? Can you prove that Wisconsin election results are inaccurate? Yes, there is a problem. There is a problem that these managers are operating a computerized decision-making system that has a tiny fraction of the integrity that this system has. Human beings are capable of verifying the accuracy of their computerized decision-making systems. One of these managers is doing it and one is not. Yes, I have proof that there is a problem. Or more specifically, political science researchers have proof that there is a problem. When you are dealing with a computer literate electorate and you operate a system like this, you are eroding voter confidence and you are eroding voter turnout. And there is only one way to build confidence in a computer literate electorate, and that's to run a verified accurate election system. We would not tolerate this from the managers that operate the computers that tabulate our grocery bill at the scanners. We would not tolerate an IT management system like this from the city treasurer who uses computers to calculate our property tax bills. This is the only computerized decision-making system in the state of Wisconsin, in either the public or the private sector, where we just allow unverified computer output to make the decision for us. Now, the recount showed us what happens when you operate a computerized decision-making system for a decade without checking its accuracy. You can imagine what would happen with the bank and the ATM. Before the recount, Wisconsin county canvassers and county clerks had certified election results in every county. They certified a vote total for every candidate in every ward across the state, thousands of vote totals. Those pre-recount totals are still on the Wisconsin Election Commission website. Then Jill Stein and her supporters and those of us that contributed to that research bought verification and made them check the accuracy of their work. And the county canvassers went back and reviewed the accuracy of their work. And they filed new vote totals. A total for every candidate in every ward across the state. Any one of you can go on to the Wisconsin Election Commission website, get a spreadsheet, compare those two totals. The vote totals differed after the recount, before the recount, by 17,681 votes. The county clerks changed the totals by 17,681 votes with the recount. That's how sloppy a system gets when it never checks its accuracy. Now, Damian Christensen and I are going to have a breakout session following this about the results of the recount. We'll go into more detail about what caused those vote changes in the recount. But I'm going to tell you one story right now. I can explain 304 of those votes right now. In the city of Marinette, they used a machine called the Optech Eagle to count their early and absentee ballots. And on election night, in the three precincts where those machines were used, the poll workers pushed a button, printed out a tape, and those three tapes together said, we didn't see votes for president on 23.6% of the ballots. Almost a quarter of the ballots that were counted by those machines in the city of Marinette appeared to be blank for president. Now, I heard the groan. You all heard the groan. That's not possible. That is an obvious electronic miscount. Now, what does the state of Wisconsin's canvas procedure do? What kicks in when the tape shows even an obvious miscount? The poll workers looked at the tape and they certified that the ballots had been counted correctly, not the votes, just the ballots. They sent those election results to the municipal canvas. The municipal canvas looked at those tapes that showed an obvious electronic miscount, and they certified those results without investigation and without correction, and they sent them to the county canvas. Now, if you study Wisconsin statutes and you really look for the buck stops here responsibility for accurate election results, especially in the national race, it lies with the county canvas. So the city canvas sent those results to the county canvas, and the Marinette County canvas looked at them and certified the results as true and correct. We have reviewed these results. We find them to be true and correct. Signed statements, send it to the state. No investigation, no correction. Wisconsin Election Commission posted those on the website as certified election results and said, unless someone demands a recount, this is what we're certifying for our presidential election results. Fortunately, this time, someone came along and demanded a recount, but most of the time, people don't. And if those results had been certified as final, 304 voters in the city of Marinette alone would have been completely disenfranchised. Now, this, I don't want to sound bleak, this is a solvable problem. More than 20 states now verify the election results are accurate before they certify. Wisconsin could too. There's modern techniques that are efficient and reliable and economical. This is something any municipal or county clerk in Wisconsin could be doing now under state law. And in our workshop, we'll describe more about how that could happen. And we'll also describe more about the recount. But my 10 minutes are up, and I just want to say, if you want to find out more about how our votes are counted, how we could get verified, accurate results brought home to Wisconsin, and more about the details of what we discovered in the recount, go to wisconsinelectionintegrity.org. Or come to the breakout workshop. So again, I'm Karen McKim, Wisconsin Election Integrity Action Team. Thanks so much. Let's get our votes counted.
John Nichols, if you'd like to come up, and we got a chair for you. Okay. Our next presenter, before I go to our next presenter, I wanted to ask after everybody got here for us to acknowledge a couple of people who were warriors on behalf of our democracy, and I'd like to ask you to give a moment of silence for these two folks. As you know, Ed Garvey, Member Flora, he had a direct, intimate connection to this event first couple of years when we were just getting started. He was willing to give us his support and come out and be a key presenter a number of times, and we remembered him always for that. And also Linda Wyeth, who was a citizen journalist, passed away this fall. You would have seen her in a lot of events around the state of Wisconsin doing citizen journalism. So I'd like to ask you to give a moment of silence to honor these two warriors for our democracy. Thank you. Our next speaker is Katherine Cramer, who you probably heard about her book, The Politics of Resentment. Has a lot to say about the state of people's understanding of each other and their relationships. And I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Katherine Cramer.
Really an honor to be here, and I'm feeling bad that my back is towards some of you, so I'm going to try and take this out so I can see you. Okay, so I'm feeling very proud to be a Wisconsinite this morning. It's really great to be here. The title of my book and the topic of what I have to share with you all, I know, is pretty depressing, but I'm going to try to be uplifting as possible. Briefly, I'm just going to explain what I did and how I did it, because I think one of your themes today, one of our themes today, is listening. And I've learned a lot about listening in the past decade, and so I want to share a bit of what I know. So about a decade ago, back in 2007, I had just earned tenure at UW-Madison, and while I was sprinting for tenure, I was trying to design a study that got me out and about around this state that I love, that helped me understand how people interpret politics. I wasn't looking for a rural versus urban divide. Honestly, I grew up in just north of the Milwaukee metro area in Grafton, which is now part of the metro area. Spent most of my life in the state, but was not aware of the resentment that I was about to hear. But I sampled communities from across the state, knowing that in each of these places I was going to try to find a group of regulars to just invite myself into, because I found over time that the best way to learn about how people interpret politics is to sit down with them and listen to them talk to the people in their lives and the places that they normally hang out in, not to call them in for an interview with me, a researcher on a college campus, but to go where they are in the course of their everyday lives. And so I sampled these communities from across the state with the help of local newspaper editors or extension agents. I said, where in such and such Wisconsin do people go on a regular basis where they just hang out with one another? And they pointed me to gas stations and diners and McDonald's and churches and such. And I would drive out to the community that I'd sample, typically early in the morning. Typically these are morning coffee clutches, and I'd walk in and I would say, hi, I'm Kathy from University of Wisconsin-Madison. Do you mind if I join you this morning? And they would laugh and they would say, sure. So now we've got nothing better to do. And then I would tell them who I was. I'd give them my business card, a token of my appreciation, which I then quickly said, this is not paid for by your taxpayer dollars. Donated by the Alumni Association, and then I would turn on my recorder and ask, tell me, what are the big concerns around here? And they would tell me. And we would visit and talk, and I would go back a few months later, a year later, and again, and I was spending time in our cities and in our suburbs, but also in our small communities and our rural places. And about a year in, it was pretty obvious that a lot of what I was hearing was folks in these smaller places were telling me we are not getting our fair share. And they were telling me that with respect to the cities. So what they were conveying to me is that, you know, it seems to us that all the stuff goes to the cities, all the attention, all the resources, and all the respect. By that I mean, they were telling me, you know, basically in Wisconsin, there's Madison and Milwaukee, and then there's the rest of us. Sometimes they say Madison, Milwaukee, the M&Ms, right? How many of you heard that Madison and Milwaukee referred to that way? Well, then there's also this term outstate, right, which really rubs people the wrong way. Outstate? How can we be outstate? Like, we're part of Wisconsin too, right? Well, folks were telling me, you know, all the decisions are made in Madison or Milwaukee, and they're communicated out to the rest of us, and it's just not the case that there's any listening going on in reverse. People are not paying attention to what's going on in our community. And then they would also tell me, you know, Madison sucks in all of our taxpayer dollars, spends them on itself or on Milwaukee, and we don't see that money in return. We don't get our fair share of that money. And finally, and I think most importantly now, in retrospect, looking back at the 2016 election, they were telling me, we don't get our fair share of respect. Those people making decisions don't know us, they're not familiar with us, they haven't spent time with us, and they actually don't really even like us. They think we're not educated and that we're racist and sexist and all the rest. A lot of other great things were going on in these places, don't get me wrong. And to be honest, as sobering as that all is, my time with these folks has been absolutely delightful. I mean, they've welcomed me in. A lot of times they're telling me this stuff through jokes, and it can be pretty enjoyable. But it's also pretty darn serious, and we've seen how it's mattered for our politics over the past few years. I thought I was done with my field work about 2009, and then Scott Walker got elected as governor, and I realized I have more to learn here. And I finished up my book in 2012, published it. 2016 campaign rolls around. It's time for me to go back and deliver a copy to all these folks, and I'm realizing I have more to learn here. Because what we saw was this sentiment of not getting one's fair share. That's part of the politics of resentment, but the other part is the way in which politicians can use it, tap into it, right? So Scott Walker comes around and he says, you're right, those public employees getting way more than their fair share. They're making way much more money than you. They have health care, they have pensions, and people had been saying to me since 2007, look, here's the deal. I can't afford health care for myself or for my family. And I'm being asked to pay taxes for those state workers, those public employees who do have health care. How does that compute, right? How is it fair that I'm paying for them to have health care when I can't even afford it myself? And so when Scott Walker came around, he said, you're right, roll it back, make them pay in more. That resonated with a lot of folks, right? Donald Trump comes along, very different politician, but basically he's saying, you're right, things are broken, you're right to be mad, you do deserve more than you're getting, and you know what? The people who are getting what you think you deserve don't deserve it, right? Immigrants, Muslims, uppity women, whichever group you want to point out, right? So these sentiments, they matter because people are figuring out how to tap into them. It's not necessarily new, right? I'm sure many of you who are familiar with our smaller communities in the state sort of know that it's kind of always been the case, right, that Madison and Milwaukee get all the attention and all this stuff. But something's different now, whether it's people figured out how to tap into it or it's the confluence of all these different things going on, globalization, change in our economy, technology, what have you. But it's a sentiment that really matters a lot. Okay, so here's my more uplifting part, and that's about the listening. Because a lot of times people approach me these days and say, how did you do that? That must have been so difficult to go and listen to these folks and have these conversations with these folks. And really the most difficult part was just getting out of my car and getting into the gas station, like taking the big deep breath. But as soon as I said, hi, I'm Kathy, I'm here to listen to you. It was easy, because it's not very common that any of us get asked, what do you think? What are you concerned about? And then just have someone sit there and listen, as opposed to, okay, well, here's what I have to tell you. Here's what I'm selling you, right? People so appreciated the fact that I was there to just spend time with them and to listen to their concerns. And here's some examples. So there, I can imagine, or I can remember One time in one of our medium-sized cities, I walked into a group of folks having breakfast, and they said, "No way can you turn that recorder on, no way." And then 45 minutes later, they were saying, "Oh, can't you stay 5 more minutes? Joe's about to show up, and when are you coming back?" Right? And so as we talk, people realize, oh, it's really valuable to talk about what we think and to express our concerns. Well, when I'd show up to these groups a second time, they would often be just surprised. "You're back." You know? I'd show up a third time, and they would be absolutely bewildered. "You're serious about this?" And I'd say, "Yes, I am." And I think that my experience of how much people appreciated being listened to was really powerful. And I think it has gone a long way towards showing me just how much that is missing in our public life. We don't have time to listen, right? We don't have time. Well, I think we need to make time. But that brings me to a final point, and that is it the case that listening to some points of view legitimizes them? That's a really important question. I think our sense, the sense you get from a lot of national media these days is that those people in rural America have these frightening views of other people in the population. But those of you, I know many of you here today, know from your personal experience, well, that's not right. That is not quite right, right? And it's not my experience either. When these folks are telling me that they're resentful, they're not using that word, right? That's my word I'm putting on it. What they're telling me is like, we are struggling to make ends meet, and something is broken because we can't. And it doesn't seem like anyone's listening to that, and it doesn't seem like anyone is giving us the stuff we need in order to thrive. Sometimes what I hear is scary and racist and sexist and homophobic and Islamophobic, but most of the time what I hear is people saying, "We are trying to do this as best we can, and it seems like nobody notices." So I say all that to say, there's some struggle these days about what the trick is. Do we now turn our attention to white folks in rural America, or do we turn our attention to people of color in our cities? And I don't think either is the solution. I think what we need to notice is that when you hear what I'm describing about what I've heard in rural Wisconsin, in some respects, it's exactly the same message as we hear in other parts of our state, other parts of our country, right? So when you think about what people say in Madison, people of color have been saying for decades about what it's like to live in Madison. What they're saying is, no one's giving us attention, right? No one's listening to our concerns. They're also saying, we don't get the stuff we need in order to thrive. And they're also saying, you know what? Those people making decisions, they don't know us, they don't understand us, and they don't respect us. So I think the thing to notice is there's something fundamentally broken, right? It's not about rural America. It's not about our cities. It's about all of us. And that's why it's so great to be with you all here today, because I think you share that concern with me. And just by showing up on a rainy Saturday morning, you're showing that you want to do something about it. So it's my honor to be here, and have a great day. Thank you.
That's a big challenge. And I also happen to wear another hat beside co-chair of the Wisconsin Grassroots Network, and that's chair of the Rural Caucus. And so I've been aware of a lot of what Katherine just said for a long time. Many of you have too. And of course, there's another shoe to drop, and that's, what do we do about it? And that's why it's very important that we take action And part of it, I think, is what Katherine has undermined, and that is listening. And that's, we need to be out in the community respectfully interacting with our neighbors, because they do have something important to say, whether they are in our political value system or in another one. And often I'm amazed to find how much, when you really dig deep into a person's history and their persona, you find out there's a lot that you share. And there are common values that underline a lot of our life experience. But you gotta take a little time, and you gotta get past some of that superficial rhetoric, which the media, of course, inflames. And I'm not saying the media is bad, but I'm saying that it's easy to get real fired up about, you know, what you see and hear. So our next presenter, like myself, shares a real background in rural Wisconsin. I come from a long history of dairy farming, and our next speaker has some of that history too. And she's gonna share with us a perspective about what's going on in our legislature, but more, perhaps more important, what's going on in rural Wisconsin. Kathleen Vinehout.
Thanks for giving up your Saturday, and I have a feeling you're going to take home a treasure, and certainly we've just heard two sides of that, and I'm going to add one more side to it, and when you get done, you'll wonder, did we plan all this? And I have to say, it's all made and all is organized, and you happened to bring the right people together at the right time. So thank you. I'm humbled to be here. Shell-shocked. That was the way one of the strong Dems described to me the feeling after the election. We don't know where to go. We don't know what to do, my friend told me. What to do next? That's what I'm here to talk about. I suggest that we begin with the numbers, and not the media's interpretation of the numbers, but actually the numbers themselves. Give some perspective and provide a basis for moving forward. And I think about that media's perspective and then the actual numbers, and it takes me back to 4 years ago when we heard that the GOP, because of the demographics, was about to become extinct. Clearly that was wrong. Now the Democrats are being told we're toast. All those rural people were motivated by Trump to vote, and many of them for the very first time, and they all showed up and were toast. We're not toast. We gotta suit up and get back on the field. But it is true that Trump motivated a lot of new voters to go to the polls. I've been doing some homework, talking with election judges, talking with county clerks, looking at voter registration documents, looking at ward results. And I estimate that in my part of the state, roughly 10% of the people who went to the polls were new voters, and most of those new voters voted for the very first time. They registered, most of them registered on election day. In one city, in Whitehall, in Trempealeau County, I physically counted the new voter registrations in all of Trempealeau County, and I found that there, of all the voters who voted in Whitehall, 24% of them were brand new voters registering for the first time. 24%. And when I looked at the voter registration applications, I could tell because they had to have their birthday, about what age they were, and they were in their 30s, 40s, 50s. Sometimes they voted in family blocks. So I remember there were about 8 or 10 Grassroots from Osseo that all voted. And a lot of them lived in the same address, and you could tell they were family members, brothers, sisters, wives. But at the same time, those people who usually show up in a presidential year and usually vote Democratic didn't show up in the North and the West. The North and the West, Hillary got slightly more than a usual off year or a non-presidential year. So she didn't motivate other voters to come to the polls. She just got the people who were motivated to come, and they were like you and me, and they vote in every election, and they certainly vote in every off-year election. And we were overly optimistic about Election Day. And the media told us we were a blue state. That Wisconsin hadn't voted for a Republican presidential candidate since Reagan. True, but that's only part of the story. Three of the last presidential races were decided by 22,000 votes or less. So there was Kerry, there was Gore in 2000, won by 5,000 votes. Kerry won by only 10,000 votes. And then, of course, Trump won by 22,000 votes. And Republicans have won the last 7 of the last 9 races for governor. We are not a blue state. We are a swing state. And we, as Democrats, have to fight for every vote in every election. I'm grateful that the media is finally focusing on rural Wisconsin, and that folks in my part of the state are being listened to. And yes, the numbers tell us that if Hillary had gotten the normal presidential Democratic vote in the West and in the North, we would have won, the Democrats and Hillary would have won the state. So there's a lot of work to do in my world, in the West and the North. But the focus on rural, and only rural, is incomplete. That's not only what the numbers tell us. The numbers tell us if Hillary had gotten the 2012 Democratic vote out of Milwaukee County, she would have won the state. The numbers tell us if Hillary had gotten a normal Democratic presidential year vote out of the suburbs, she would have won the state. If Hillary had gotten the normal presidential year Democratic vote out of central Wisconsin, she would have won the state. If Hillary had gotten the normal presidential year Democratic vote out of Fox Valley, she would have won the state. Any one of these scenarios, not all of them, would have swung Wisconsin to the win column. So the numbers tell us to win, we need to campaign and compete all across the state, in our major cities, in Madison, Milwaukee, in the fast-growing suburbs, all around the Madison, Milwaukee, but also across from St. Paul, in the Fox Valley, in the middle-sized cities, and in the rural areas. What this tells us is no matter where you live in Wisconsin, there's work to do. But it's good to know we're not toast. So to win, we can't take anything for granted. Every voter has to be romanced. Every non-voter has to be convinced that this election matters, and that Democratic programs and Democratic policies will make people's lives better, and they will make our community stronger. We are one state. Our concerns are the same, whether we're rural, urban, or suburban. And thank you, Dr. Cramer, for leading us there, because I'm right with you. So, specifics. We love specifics on issues. We all want good schools. We want great schools. We all want safe streets. We all want a clean environment. We want efficient transportation. good roads, but also good mass transit. We want fast broadband. We couldn't live without fast broadband, but in my world, a lot of places in Wisconsin we do. And we want a good paying job. Now, the answers might be different in different parts of the state, but the problems are the same. So we need to talk solutions that make sense to every voter, no matter where they live in the state. And we have to empower local government, cities, counties, towns, villages across the state to make the best decisions that work for their local communities, which means Madison and the Republicans need to stop dictating a one-size-fits-all out of the Capitol from elected officials for the whole state. Is it just like that? So if we want to win statewide elections, we have to advance ideas that resonate across the state, from Green Bay to Greenfield, from Appleton to Ashland, from Milwaukee to Mindoro, from Beloit to Balsam Lake, from Madison to Menominee, from Racine to River Falls, from Excelsior to River to Eagle River. Yes, all over the state. One of the finest moments of Obama's presidency, I thought, was his farewell speech in Chicago. And I go back to that speech and take inspiration from it. And he gave us a roadmap for thinking about the future. If we don't create opportunity for all people, the disaffection and the division that has stalled our progress will only sharpen in the years to come. If every economic issue is framed as a struggle between hardworking white middle class and an undeserving minority, then workers of all shades are going to be left fighting for scraps while the wealthy further withdraw to their private enclaves. Those are Obama's words. And despite what Governor Walker would have us believe, these economic issues are starker in Wisconsin than